But I am here as a watchman on the wall to tell you that God wants more, that he's not satisfied with seconds, and he will not give his affection to something else. He's a jealous God. He wants all of you, every bit of you. In 2 Chronicles 29, we'll be reading there for a moment. But the Lord had taken me on a journey this week. As I sat in a hotel room, as I fought traffic to get to meetings, and I just soaked up the presence of God in a room of 70 generals in the kingdom. Felt like I was the least among my brethren. Oh, what God did in my heart. When God has to take you back to the day that you first remembered, to the day that you first surrendered and believed. And I thought about our church, and I thought about it in the term of Hezekiah's reformation. That Hezekiah, all the way up into 2 Chronicles until we get to chapter 29, he has spent so much time trying to undo the damage of his father Ahaz, who had been king before him. And sometimes you have to contend with the stuff your family put on you. You're dealing with the stuff that your grandparents put on you. They put on their children. And it showed up as a residual in some diabolical form. It's manifested itself. And you can't seem to get away from it, for its ugly head is cropped up again. And Hezekiah spends time trying to reform and bring revival back to Judah. He wanted to restore true worship. When we stood here on this platform this morning and you stood in your pew, and we lifted our hands to a holy God, we were saying, Lord, I want to worship you in spirit and in truth. I want to worship you from a place of truth. I worship you because you are good. You are hallowed. You are lovely. You are worthy. You are full of glory. And I worship you in truth. See, if the enemy can keep you from worshiping God in truth, he can keep you bound up. But the Bible said, who the Son sets free, he is free indeed. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Am I speaking to anybody this morning that's been free? Free from the chains of oppression? Free from the diabolical form of demonic activity? Free from addiction, free from homosexuality, free from perversion, free from all manner of vices and vexations. Is there anybody that would stand on their feet this morning and say, I want to thank God that he didn't leave me like he found me? Is there any truth worshipers? Is there anybody in the house that can say, if it had not been for the truth of God, I'd still be locked up somewhere, but he has set me free? If you praise him this morning because he liberated you, give him honor, give him praise, give him truth this morning. Woo! Come on, somebody begin. Come on, somebody begin to give him a fire praise. A fire praise. Shut up in my belly. Shut up in my spirit. There's a fire in me that wants to get out. I don't worship because I have to. I worship because I want to. You can't steal my praise. I come through too much. Come over too much. Whew. You may be seated. Yes. I read an article this week, said the reasons why I'm giving up sports. And I read this and I smiled. The article said, I'm giving up sports I'm giving up football in the fall. I'm giving up baseball in the summer. And I'm giving up basketball in the winter. I've had all I can take. And it went on to say, I quit attending sports once and for all. And here are 11 reasons. Number one, every time I went to the game, they asked me for money. Number two, the people I sat next to didn't seem friendly. Number three, the seats were too hard and not comfortable at all. Number four, I went to many games, but the coach never came to call on me. Number five, the referees made decisions that I couldn't agree with. Number six, the game went into overtime and I was late getting home on Wednesday night. I added that last. All right. Number seven, the band played numbers I'd never heard before, and it just wasn't my style of music. Number eight, it seems the games are always scheduled when I want to do other things. Number nine, I suspect that I was sitting next to some hypocrites. They came to see their friends, and they talked the whole game. Number 10, I was taken to too many games by my parents when I was growing up. Number 11, I hate to wait in the traffic jam in the parking lot after the game is over. And as I read that article, I had to snicker and laugh because I knew it was a parallel to a contrast to the way sometimes we think, even when it comes to serving and living a love relationship with Jesus and coming to his house and being thankful that we are on the wake-up list. Because if it had not been for God, I'd be somewhere out of my mind right now. I had a nervous breakdown a long time ago. If it hadn't been for God. You can't come into the presence of God and never be the same. A true worshipful experience is the mark of a revived church and the mark of a revived believer. When you can worship God in truth, it is an evidence that you have been in the presence of the King. You have been in the presence of the one that called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And the real tragedy in any church is that we could be in revival all the time if we wanted to. We have the opportunity to worship him. We have the privilege to worship him. Every service that we're here together, we could just come right in and enter into the presence of God. No holds barred, no restrictions. We could praise him and release the fire of God. But there must be preparation in worship, and that preparation in worship involves a covenant. And I want you to write this down because I really believe that God is trying to get his church prepared. The Bible begins to speak to us in 2 Chronicles 29, and I have like 10 pages of notes here. I made it to like the second page in the first service. I don't know, I can promise that, but because you're not in a hurry. Second Chronicles 29, verse 10 is the conversation that Hezekiah is having with God. And I believe that he's calling this mature church to enter into the same type of thinking. And the Bible says that Hezekiah said, "Now it is in my heart to make a covenant with the Lord God of Israel." Now you have to remember he's got to this place because the first 28 chapters, there's been reform, there's been transition. There's been generational transition. And he has spent the better part of his life seeking after God. There was a time that Hezekiah had a great sickness in his life. And the prophet showed up to the house and said, "God told me to tell you that your days are over. You will not survive this sickness." But the Bible said that Hezekiah turned his face to the wall, and he began to worship, and he began to pray. Have you ever been where you had to turn your face to the wall? There was no hope. There was no answer. There was no remedy. There was no 12-step plan. He turned his face to the wall, And he began to cry unto the God that he served. And he began to worship the one that had called him. And he began to ask God to have mercy. And he began to petition God. And the Bible said that before the prophet ever pulled out of the driveway, that the God spoke to the prophet and said, I have heard the cry of my child. And he told him to go back in, and the prophet went back in and said, Hezekiah, before I ever got out of your driveway, God told me to come back and tell you, I've given you 15 more years to live. That's what worship can do. It can bring you into years. It can bring you into decades. It can bring you into seasons. It can bring you into dimensions. It can bring you into atmospheres. It can bring you past the galaxy. I serve the God that walks on the wings of the wind. I serve one that tiptoes across the Milky Way. He holds the world in his hand. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And if God is God, he's true. And if God be God, let every man be a lie. Because God's word will stand even when the world's in hell and the world is collapsing around us. It's not a Republican world. It's not a Democratic world. It's the world that belongs to God. And the Bible said eventually the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdom of our God. Hezekiah said, I've got to make a covenant with God again. And then he speaks this language. I'm making a covenant so that the fierce wrath of God will be turned away from us. When you get desperate for God, you'll come to him and you'll cry out to him. Because when you get tired of living in the hell you're in, you won't seek the hellish forecast of a horoscope, a charmer, anybody that can read tea leaves, or anybody that can predict your future. You don't have to listen to hell when you can get a word from heaven, because God can speak rivers into your soul. Somebody said, that's just a little too bold for me. Hogwash. You've watched Jerry Springer all week. I've come to tell you that God wants you to live in freedom and come out of. I don't care what Oprah says or what Dr. Phil says. I don't even care what Howard Stern said. I come to tell somebody, you got to turn to God so his face will turn away from the wrath that has come. He made a covenant with God, and then he said to his sons, my sons, be not now negligent, for the Lord hath chosen you to stand before him, to serve him, to minister to him, and to burn incense. And for the note takers and the preachers that are always looking for a point, here you go. He spoke to his sons. And we are living now in an apostolic reformation. Nearly 15 years ago, there was delivered to me a book called Apostolic Reformation by David Cartledge, who is an apostle in Australia. And God began to shape him to understand the Father-Son dynamic of kingdom advancement here on the other side of the cross in a New Testament dispensation, as was spoken in Malachi 4, where the Word of God said that in the last day he was sent the spirit of Elijah. We know that John the Baptist fulfilled that in the New Testament, and that he would turn the hearts of the fathers to the sons and the hearts of the sons to the fathers, lest he smite the earth with a curse. And we have lived under a curse of a fatherless generation. Our prisons are full of men and women who had no father, who had nobody to train them, had nobody to instruct him. And that spirit has gotten loose, not only in the world, it has even tried to creep into the church, where nobody wants to be told what to do, where nobody wants to be a submissive, and nobody wants to be instructed, because we've got this rebellious spirit in us. But God said, I'm coming with the spirit of Elijah. I'm coming to restore. I'm coming to bring back a reconciliation. I'm coming back to bring kingdom advancement. And so Hezekiah said to his sons, this is what you're going to do. You're going to stand up and you're going to serve the Lord, and you're going to minister to the Lord, and you're going to burn incense in his presence. And I like it that, because in the New Testament, the Bible says that you and I, that our life becomes a fragrance to God, that we are living epistles read of all men openly. My Bible tells me in Romans 12 that I'm not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of my mind, so I can prove what is that good, perfect, and acceptable will of God. I lay my life life on the altar that I might become a fragrance to God. I lay my life on the altar that the Spirit of God might consume every part of me. And when the fire of God comes upon me, you won't smell the stench of my flesh. You will smell the sweetness of the Spirit of God, because there's a new flavor and a new fragrance in me. If you believe it, say amen. Look at your neighbor and say, I smell you. Just going to church is not enough. Filling a pew is not enough. Working the nursery in the first service, slipping out so you don't have to come to the second service, is not enough. It's not enough just to go to church. Worship begins with a commitment, a covenant to God. And it was so important that Hezekiah said to his sons that the leadership has to demonstrate the passion of worship. I long time gave up trying to worry about what folks thought about me. There used to be a time, Sister Talisa, that I didn't want nobody to see me worship. I was too timid. I didn't want nobody to think I was strange. I grew up in Pentecost. I grew up in old-time Pentecost. I grew up when they preached Mad Dog. I grew up where they preached, you couldn't even understand what they were saying. But we shouted. We thought you were anointed because you sweat through your suit. The fact is, you were probably overweight and the heat was on. But we thought people were anointed. Are you here? The leadership have to demonstrate worship. And if I only demonstrate worship when I'm standing up here before you, this is not a performance and this is not a show. But I'm here for the audience of one. I'm here to do for him what he cannot do for himself. I've come to praise him. I've come to magnify him. I've come to lift him up because he's worthy. If anybody knows that he's worthy, you ought to give God some praise right now, because he wants your praise. He wants your worship. He wants you to exalt him. Come on and bless the Lord. Come on and bless the Lord. So I have to model worship. And when I'm not the one preaching and someone else is preaching, I'm on them like a pit bull. I'm saying, come on, preach now. Shuck the corn, spank the devil, shame him. Come on, I'm in there. I'm praising with them. Why? Because I have a shared anointing. And I know that when they step into the river of God, that there is an anointing that can come from the pulpit all the way to the pew. And the reason God brings it from the pulpit to the pew is to get me out of the pew and into the streets where I can reach people with that same anointing. You have the same anointing on you. You have the same spirit on you. But you've got to facilitate worship in his presence. Moms and dads have to worship so their children can see tears falling down their face. Mom and dads need to illustrate worship so children don't think this is some strange thing. I've never seen daddy act like that. I've never seen mommy act like that. Let me tell you, beloved, I grew up in a Christian home, of which I'm thankful. But my parents, before they came to Christ, they didn't live for the Lord. And they didn't, even though their mom and daddy and both of them had their journey, and they had been in church for a little bit and here and there. And my daddy told the story last weekend when I was with him, that in the winter time, that my grandfather, Jim Hylton, my daddy's dad, he had the responsibility of going down to the old Rock House Unity Free Will Baptist Church. And they had to go there, and it was his turn. He would keep the fire lit. And they had an old burning stove that kept the whole church lit. And my grandfather, my papa, he'd go down there and take my daddy with him. And they'd build a fire and they'd put it in that church. And sometimes it would be so, the snow was so bad and the roads were so bad that nobody could get to the church. And it would have been easy for my papa to say, I'm staying home because ain't nobody gonna show up. But he had a job to do. He was a keeper of the oil. My God, I didn't even know the heritage God's given me. And he would go down to the church and build a fire in that old stove and try to get the heat in the building. building, and when nobody else showed up, my papa got down on his face and began to cry out to God, and my daddy sat there and watched the power of God. You gotta be a worshiper. You gotta keep the oil lit. You gotta keep the fire lit. I don't care if nobody shows up. You gotta show up. My God, I feel good. I can't get you to do what you've got to do for yourself. And the Bible said that Hezekiah said to his sons, we have got to worship God again. So I want you to stand before him. I want you to stand before him. That's good. Woo. Well, there's an anointing in the house. Hey! Shake us again, Lord. Take us back again. So he said, I want you to stand before me. And then he said, I want you to serve him. I've been asking you to show up on Friday night. I've been asking you to show up on Saturday. Some of you disobedient. He said, I don't have to. It's not my area of ministry. But Hezekiah said to his sons, is there any sons in this house today? Is there anybody that claims the Lord today? Is there anybody that's part of this church that says, yes, this is my house? If that's you, lift your hand and begin to thank God that you even have a house, that you even have a place to worship. You ought to thank God. He said, stand up. He said, serve him. He said, minister to him. And he said, burn with an incense. That's your worship. When you begin to burn in his presence and the fire of God hits you and you give off the smell of heaven, you may be seated. So they had to get everything clean. Let me ask you this morning, is your house clean? If we all went to your house after church, would we have to wait out in the parking lot or the driveway for 15 minutes? Turn to your neighbor and say, Lucille, he's talking to you. You got to get clean. Won't he make you? Won't he make you inside? Won't he make you clean inside? Won't he make you clean inside? You know the song? Won't he make you? You don't know this? Won't he make you inside? Come on, sing it. Won't he make you clean inside? Yeah, won't he make you clean? Come on, give somebody a high five. Tell him, won't he make you? Won't he make you clean inside? Won't he make you clean inside? Say, yes, he will. I'm almost done. The Bible said they had to clean the house. They had to get themselves ready to worship again. If you ever come to church and you've been fighting with your family, some of you been fussing before you got here today. Some of you were cussing before you got here today. That's all right. The Holy Ghost has a big bar of soap. He's going to take care of it all. Won't he make you? Won't he make you? Sing it with me now. Won't he make you? Smile when you say it. Inside, hey, won't he make you clean? Inside. So he speaks to his sons like I'm speaking to this congregation. It's time to stand up. It's time to serve. It's time to minister. It's time to burn so that we smell like him, that I give off the right fragrance. And then Hezekiah says that the next step is we've got to get rid of the clutter. If we are to be prepared to worship in this house, the clutter has got to go. I don't want to call anybody out and say that anyone in the room is a hoarder, but chances are somebody has been hanging on to stuff. If you wear a size 20, you are not going to be wearing an 8 tomorrow. Tell your neighbor, clean the clutter. Less is more. On April 28th, my daughter is leaving the house to join with her husband, who's not her husband yet. And she's taking her clutter with her. Of which I probably paid for all of it. But anyhow, won't he make me? Woo! Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody been there and be like, I'm remodeling that room inside a new gymnasium, yeah. A new theater for me, yeah. Man, this service is so much different than the first service. But in verse 12, he said the Levites arose. Now, this is after they have stood up, they've served, they've ministered, and they've burned. Then the Levites showed up. Who are the Levites? They're a tribe that come from the tribe of Levi. And the Bible teaches us that the Levites were the people who came along and served along with the priests. So it's like the pastoral staff and the ministry coordinators coming together. The priesthood and the Levites. The Bible said the Levites rose. They didn't rise until the leaders rose. They can't rise till the leadership gets it right. Your children can't rise till you get it right. Read on down to verse 15, if you will. The Bible said they gathered their brethren and they sanctified themselves and they came according to the commandment of the king by the words of the Lord to cleanse the house of the Lord. So when the leadership got it right and they began to worship again right and their hearts were right, the Levites rose up as well. Because when you go up, you bring everybody up with you. The Levites rose up, Pastor. And the Bible said they sanctified themselves because they were about to enter into the house of God. And you don't come into the presence of God with dirty hands. You don't come into the presence of God. You don't get on this platform and minister with sin in your life. They did according to the Lord's commandment and they came to cleanse the house. And the Bible said in verse 16, the priest went into the inner part of the house of the Lord to cleanse it. And they brought out all the uncleanness that they had found in the temple of the Lord into the court of the house of the Lord. Now I want you to notice that the pastors, the priesthood had to go into the inner sanctum, into the inner place. And they had to do what the Levites could not do. Ministers, hear me. You have to do what you can do and only what you can do. But if you don't do your part, others can't do theirs. And the priesthood had to go into the inner place. That's where they were called. I want you to know, as a pastor, I'm not called to do everything in this house. I'm called to make sure that it gets done, but I'm here to equip you to do the work of ministry. That's the way God has set it up in the New Testament church. And if I do it all, you will expect me to do it all. But I'm here to release you to do the ministry of the Lord. But the ministers had to go into the inner part and they had to take care of the unclean thing. And if there's anything unclean in your heart, you have to take care of it. You have to deal with you. My wife's not going to get me to heaven. My mama's prayers, I love my mom and dad, but they're not going to get me to heaven. I got to deal with me. Every day, on the daily, I got to deal with me. And the Bible said they went in and they cleaned out the dirty things that were there. And they brought them out. And then the Bible says the Levites took it up and they carried it out into the brook Kidron. And I thought, as I read that this morning, that I was reading about Kidron, that it just quickened to my spirit that Kidron was the valley that was referred to as the Valley of Jehoshaphat. And it was also Kidron where David had to walk and hide in the tombs when he was on the run from his son Absalom. He had to go through the dry place of Kidron. Kidron had become a junkyard. Kidron had become a place where people would throw things away. You ever drove down the road and saw that people just laid trash out somewhere? That's what Kidron was. The Bible said that even Jesus took many of his journeys. He had to travel through Kidron, the Kidron Valley. Oh, it just speaks of what that meant. Sometimes God will take you through dirty places. He'll take you through places where it will be rough on your feet. He will have you go in places that you can only trust his voice because you don't know. Why did you put me here, God? I had it so good over here. And God said, because I am preparing you. I got to get the junk out of you. And it's easy to clap, but it's painful inside. And when the priests did their part, the Levites stepped up and they did their part because they were called to help. And they took the trash and they took it to the Kidron Valley. And look at verse 17. The Bible says they begin on the first day of the first month to sanctify. And on the eighth day of the month, they came to the porch of the Lord. It took them 8 days to clean the clutter, and they had only got to the porch. Somebody say, I've been to that house. I've cleaned that house. 8 days, and they only made it to the porch. Can you imagine how you'd feel on the eighth day? Is this all we got? Boy, somebody tell them to bring another dump truck over. We need another pallet. We need another. And then the Bible says, it goes on that the Bible said they sanctified the house of the Lord in 8 days. And in the 16th day of the first month, they made an end. It took them a total of 16 days to get the house clean and ready for worship. I'm going to ask you, is it going to take you 16 days to give it all to God? Is it going to take you 16 days to lay down the habit, to crucify the flesh, to stop sleeping with someone you're not married to? It's going to take you 16 days to get rid of all that liquor and you have hidden in your house. It's going to take you 16 days to get rid of all that pornography that you've been looking at secretly on your phone, in your computer. I had a man or a woman tell Pastor Bev and I in counsel years ago. She said that her husband was so bound by pornography, the only way that he would have sexual relationship with her is he had to watch Asian porn first. And you're saying, man, you say that on a Sunday morning? You better believe it, because I believe that God wants us to be clean. And the clutter has got to go. I said, the clutter has got to go. It took him 16 days to get rid of the clutter. And then the Bible says in verse 18, they went to Hezekiah the king and they said, we have cleansed all the house of the Lord and the altar of burnt offering with all the vessels thereof and the showbread table with all the vessels thereof. Moreover, all the vessels which your father, King Ahaz, in his reign, had cast away and transgressed, we have prepared and sanctified, and behold, they are before the altar of the Lord. And what had happened was they got rid of all the clutter. And now Hezekiah said, we are ready to enter in to worship because we have not allowed defilement to come into our life. We have prepared our heart And while I was in prayer this week and I was seeking God in Houston and I was asking God to speak to my heart and to show me a revelation, and I shared with you just a few moments ago about the book that I had read 15 years ago from David Cartledge, An Apostolic Reformation, and it set me on a journey to seek the heart of the face of God for what he wants in for Bethel Family Worship Center, what he has called me to do in my own life call to raise up sons and to build the kingdom of God. And this is where it was so amazing, because I sat there in a room full of 70 generals, and I'm the least amongst my brethren, but I'm sitting there and I'm listening, and a man gets up to speak who pastors over 5,000 people in this country, and he stood there and spoke and said that his spiritual father, David Cartledge, had just been speaking to him, and it was like God said, see what I told you 15 years ago. I put this in your life. I begin to set you on a course and set you on a journey. And then another man stood up who represents the movement called Appeal to Heaven, which is the same movement that we have worked with and with some of our spiritual sons, Mark Casto also, and also Jimmy Lovejoy, and some of those, and Dutch Sheets, and the different ones that God has allowed to come into the life of your pastors and in part into our heart. And it's like nothing but divine appointment where God is saying that I am setting you up and I'm preparing your house to do something more than you could have ever saw. But you've got to get rid of the clutter, and you've got to get rid of the stuff that has been hindering you, and the stuff that has been trying to shake you down and to shackle you and to keep you bound up. God wants his church to be free. God wants his church to be liberated. He don't want any clutter in your life. It's got to go. All of that stuff has got to go. You say, Pastor, that's pretty hard and that's pretty in your face, but I'm telling you, if you want a revival, if you want God to revive you, if you want God to strengthen your marriage, if you want God to raise your kids up, if you want God to take you off drugs, if you want God to help you with the areas that you're struggling with, whether it is alcohol or whether it's some form of addiction or perversion, then you've got to get rid of the clutter. And the Bible said that the priest went in and they got the dirty place out. My God, in America, we have got to get rid of the filth that has come into the church and all the sin that has crept in. It didn't happen overnight. It has slipped in like a slithering snake. It has been like an alligator, a leviathan in the river that has tried to swallow people up and call people into darkness. But I hear the power of God through the name of Jesus Christ, that no weapon that is formed against us shall be able to prosper. I believe that if you name the name of Jesus and the blood of Jesus is applied to the doorpost of your heart, you can walk right into the middle of a hellish thing and declare that this is the house of God, and there is liberty here, and there is victory here, because I declare that who the Son sets free is absolutely free indeed. Is there anybody that believes that God can deliver? Is there anybody that believes that you're not dead, that you are alive? Is there anybody that would say, I'm getting rid of the clutter, I'm going to tell the devil, you can't have my family, you can't have my home, you can't have my life? Come on, stand to your feet and give God praise in this house. Somebody say yes. Yes, Lord, to your will and to your way. Woo. Remain standing on your feet. God has got to get the church to a place where it is clutter free. Just a moment, I want you to look at me. You have got to get rid of the clutter in your life. How do I know this? Because God's been dealing with me. You can hold on to stuff for way too long. Some of you in this room have been holding on to a grudge. Yeah, I felt it when I said it, resistance, and I'm going to say it again. You've been holding on to a grudge. You are mad at somebody, and all you're doing is poisoning yourself. They're sleeping pretty good. And you're vexed with it. You tore up from the floor up. And you're trying. You better remember what I'm saying to you. You better quit trying to pray God to get them. And you better remember that you're God's child and they're God's child. You be careful when you put your mouth on somebody. Vengeance belongs to the Lord. And by the way, God don't get folks. He loves people. He's not in the business of slapping people on the head and saying, I'm tired of you. That's not what God does. But God begins to deal with us in the area of our life that has clutter. And I wonder if there's anybody that is ready to make a new covenant with God. They would say, you know what, Pastor? I've got a little bit of clutter I need to get rid of. A grudge, hurt feelings, offense, an attitude, a sin, a secret sin. We like to come down on people when we see them do stuff. But what about the stuff nobody can see? Am I preaching to anybody? Before you rail your bony finger at somebody else, you better remember that you probably got some sin up in your heart too. And I believe this, that until Jesus comes in the cloud of glory, there will always be something in me he's after. Because I'm not home yet. I'm not home yet. But I'm walking that way. But he wants us to clean the clutter out of our heart. And he wants us to clean the clutter out of our life. And if I could just be as plain could be today. Hezekiah said, I'm going to clean this house from top to bottom. And he said, it's going to start with me. Parents, it's got to stop with you. Moms and dads, it's got to start with you. It's got to start with you. Yesterday, my mom and dad celebrated 50 years of marriage. Wow. And should the Lord tarry his coming, we will hear less and less of 50-year marriages. Are you understanding me? This is the day we're in. I'm not aggravated at it. I am aggravated at the devil. But I'm telling you that God wants there to be freedom and clutterness gone out of your life. And for just a moment, would you bow your head? And would you begin to examine your heart in a way of repentance? There's so many people in this room, I don't really know exactly what to do. But I'm going to obey the Lord, and I'm going to ask you to respond accordingly. That I want you to ask God to clean some things out of your life. You'll see, for many times we come for a positive message and a feel good, and God is trying to speak to us about where we are right now. And he's saying what you need is not just a positive message. You need a message that will positively change you, clean you. And I'm not talking about works, and I'm not talking about you doing it, but I'm asking you to allow the Holy Spirit to do it in you. That the clutter must go for once and for all. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I came home from Houston yesterday evening, and I got home and I laid my suitcase at the foot of the bed. And I opened it up and I got my toiletries out and I set them on my sink. I went to bed. My alarm went off at 3 this morning. I got up and I tripped over the suitcase. And some of us are tripping over stuff we've left cluttered on the floor. And God said, I want you to clean it. You're battling with the same thing over and over. When is it going to come to nothing? When is it going to be free from you? When are you going to be able to walk with your hands up and say, I am free from this? And I'm not preaching hocus pocus. I'm telling you that God can set you free. I hear the Holy Ghost speaking to us today about being free from addictions. And I want you to listen to me and listen to me well. I don't care who you are. You may be a minister, a preacher, a church attender. I don't know who you are, sinner or a saint. Don't matter to me. But you got some stuff you're struggling with. And God said, if you hear this message and you walk out of here and you don't let me change you, if you don't surrender this thing to me, that this thing will so absorb you that it will destroy the very good thing you have left. And I hear God speaking to somebody to let the clutter go. And if he's speaking to you, well, I don't want you to wait. I want you to jump over a seat. I want you to run up into this altar right now. Get here as fast as you can. God, I am coming for my family. I'm coming for my future. I'm coming for for my posterity. I want my children to live better than I do. I want my life to be trouble-free. I know it's not always going to be free from obstacles, but I'm asking you to help me to jump over this thing that has been cluttering my life. Come on, come on. Get as close as you can to this altar. They're coming behind you. The Holy Spirit in the room. There it is. There it is. Hallelujah! That's the real power of God upon you, sis. Woo! Glory to God. My God, I thank you for my sister who's come this morning and said, yes, Lord, lift your hands to the Lord and surrender to him fully. In the name of Jesus, you're not what people say you are. You're not what others said you are. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. God has ordained you. God's love is for you right now. His power is with you. In the name of Jesus, I decree the power of God. Woo, there's the blood of Jesus is applied to you right now. Hallelujah, you're forgiven, you're restored, you're made whole. And the power of God is with you, not only in you, but in those that are acquainted with you. In the name of Jesus, Holy Ghost, do the work. Holy Ghost, do the work. Hey, 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 in the name of Jesus. Woo, I feel the Holy Ghost in this house. Come on, come on, come on, in the name of Jesus. Yes, go ahead, in the name of Jesus. Woo, do you hear the power of God in this place? I want some children of God right now. Lift your voice and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. In the name of Jesus. 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 As your hands are lifted around this room and you begin to worship, and I want everyone in the house to begin to pray. Lift your hands in the balcony. Lift your hands on the main floor. Just begin to worship God. God, you're taking the clutter. You can have the clutter. Go ahead and surrender it to him. God, you can have it. God, you can have it. You can have it. You can have it. You can have the clutter. Today I'm cleaning out my house. Today I'm going to start with me. The Bible said that when the priests did their part, the Levites joined in. The Levites joined in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who am I speaking to today? You have a calling on your life. You have been fought. You've been hell fought for the calling of God. That is a, ooh, let him go. There, in the name of Jesus, you've been hell fought. That's the anointing of God upon you, my brother. In the name of Jesus, the call of God is upon you. And Satan has tried everything he can to destroy you. But he's a liar. He's a liar. I want you to lay your hand on your forehead and say, I do fortify my mind. I do fortify my mind and my thoughts. I will not be fought in my dreams. I will not be fought in my sleep. I will sleep well. I will walk in the newness of God. Boy, they're just everywhere. God's power is manifesting in this place. Hey, in the name of Jesus, you're going to call yourself into healing right now. The healer lives in you. The healer lives in you. No more clutter. No more clutter. No more clutter. That suicide spirit must go in the name of Jesus. Ooh, I feel a strong anointing right here. You can't have me, devil. No, no. I'm bought by the blood. I've been purchased by the Lord. In the name of Jesus, I feel the Holy Ghost. I don't know who that was for, but I just felt so strong there. I felt that so strong. Jesus, in the name of Jesus, you can't have this family. You cannot destroy this family. In the name of Jesus, they belong to you. Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus. Come on, reach out for the person that you're praying for right now. There's somebody you have a heavy burden for. I want you to cry out. I want you to cry out and groan out in your spirit. Lift their name up before the Lord. It's a family member. It's a friend. But I want you to cry out. I want you to cry out so loud they can hear you. No matter if they're in this room or if they're across another country or in another state, I want you to cry out to God. Come on. Cry out in your spirit. Cry out. Travail in your spirit. Yeah! Yeah! God's going to use you as an intercessor. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, we speak life. We speak wholeness. We speak life. Take the clutter to the junkyard. Come on, take the clutter to the junkyard. It's going, it's going, it's going. It can't stay, it can't stay. Can't stay. There's a cry. There's a cry up in here. Come on, entertain the presence of the Lord. What He'll do for one, He'll do for another. Somebody's getting a breakthrough. Yeah, hallelujah. I want you to continue to lift your voice. If you have come to be baptized in water, you'll make your way to my left. We have an usher that will receive you there. Come on and worship. Now I want you to look at me for a moment. When we were in the first service this morning, when I opened my Bible and I was getting ready to preach, the Spirit of the Lord downloaded something into my spirit. While I was speaking to the people, God was speaking to me. And there's an anointing for that to happen, Pastor. We know that. There's an anointing that... There are times when I'm ministering, God's showing me something in the spirit. And I don't know how to even say it because it's hard to even think how you could process that. But God is not limited. He is not limited. And the Lord told me. Woo, what a good when the Holy Spirit just is so free in the house. And God told me to take my shoes off. And so... I did. I slipped my shoes off like I'm doing right now. And He spoke three things to me while I was preaching. He was preaching to me. And you want to hear what He said to me? He told me that He wanted, first of all, for me to honor Him. When Moses came to the presence of God, God said, take your shoes off. The place where you stand is holy ground. When you get to a place where you have surrendered to God and you have asked God to cleanse you and you've believed by faith that He has and you have a reverential fear of God, a fear of God in the sense that you're not afraid of Him, but a fear of God that says, I don't want to do anything, God, to shame you. I want you to be high and lifted up. Then you give him honor. And if you're able to do this right where you're at, I want you to slip your shoes off. If you're able to do it, I want you to slip your shoes off. You may think I'm in the craziest church I've ever been in my life. These people have shouted. They've spoken tongues. They've cried. They've yelled. And now they're telling me to take my shoes off. And I just don't know that I'm comfortable doing that because I didn't get a pedicure. That's all right. Maybe God wants to humble you at the same time. And I'm asking you to do this. And listen, if you can't do it, I understand. But as your pastor, I've prayed for you. I've fasted for you. I have prepared my heart to minister to you weekly. And I'm calling you to a place where you would just say, I'll do that. You do the easy thing. Let God do the hard thing. And God told me this. I took my shoes off and he said, honor me. He said, I want you to honor me. When you allow the Lord to cleanse you, you are honoring him. Some of you are going to need to go home today. You need to get some junk out of your house. You need to get rid of the liquor. I said you need to get rid of the liquor. I don't care who lied to you and said Christians can drink alcohol. It's called spirits for a reason. And even while I say that, some of you are fighting against me. You're not fighting me, you're fighting God. I'm not going to tell you a lie. I'm going to tell you the truth. You need to get rid of that alcohol because it is changing your demeanor. It is altering your mind. It is a chemical that was designed to put you in a different mind. And the Bible said that you're to take authority over your mind. That you are to bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Jesus Christ. Get rid of the wine and get rid of the alcohol. I didn't intend to say any of this, but I hear the Holy Ghost saying the reason you're struggling is you have a door open in your life. And as long as that door is open, you have given access to the enemy. There are some people who won't even look at me, and I don't even know your business. But God does. I'm not against anybody. I don't know your business, and I'm glad I don't. Because I'd have to sit down and take a sabbatical with all that mess. Don't get mad at me. I'm saying, if I knew everybody's business, I couldn't even preach. He said, honor me. And the second thing he said to me was, hear me. And the reason you take your shoes off is because you're going to be here for a while. When I take my shoes off, I'm in no hurry to go nowhere. I'm going to sit and listen to what he has to say. And then the third thing he said was, I want you to herald my message. Honor me, hear me, and then herald my message. And he said that while I was preaching in the first service. Brother Dennis, God's up to something in his house. He wants us to be clean. He wants our hearts to be pure. And with your shoes off, your heart surrendered, I want you to thank God for freeing you from the clutter. See, this is just a step of your faith. I did this just not only out of obedience, but I did this because, God, I'm stepping into something. I'm stepping into something that my flesh and my way, the soles of my shoes can't even handle. But God wants to come in contact with you today. Holy Spirit's in the room. And while you're worshiping, those that are being baptized in water are here in the front. We're going to baptize now. We're believing for those. I want everyone that wants to pray. Don't move. In just a few moments, we're going to receive our morning tithe and offering and make a few announcements. Please don't leave. Because somebody's about to be baptized in water. Imagine if that was you. How many women will we rejoice? We rejoice. Hallelujah. Those that have prepared, would you just sing now for us? Come on, lift your voice.
You wash me in mercy.
Come on, sing this. We want to thank the Lord for Alicia Crumble, who has given her heart to Jesus and declared that Jesus is Lord of her life. Alicia, God bless you. We're so proud of this step that you're taking. And upon your confession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, we do now baptize you in the name of Jesus, as he commanded, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. This is Brother Roland, and he's been coming here for a good while now, and he's made his confession in faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Brother Roland, upon your confession of faith in Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life, we do now baptize you in the name of Jesus, as he commanded, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Anyone else?